Once again, a very pleasant Lord's Day sa bawat isa. And we are now to talk about this very important topic. But before that, so as what you can see, that is what we call a lighthouse, no? Which I believe every one of you are familiar with, no? The good thing about the lighthouse is that they are such a great aid sa navigation, no? For accurate navigation. They emit light and sound signal para mag-provide ng, para ma-determine yung location and also provides warning for potential hazards na pwedeng ma-encounter ng isang sail, no? Nagbibigay siya ng warning sa mga coastlines or treacherous reefs. And because of them, because of lighthouse, many are kept safe from shipwrecks and other accidents na nangyayari sa karagatan. And that's a very important thing, no? Para sa mga nag-navigate. Now, if Christians are the sailor by analogy, we can also say that we also need a lighthouse para mag-guide sa atin about what to do and what to avoid as we chart our course into the turbulency of what we call social media. So, at this point, ang lesson po natin, mga kapatid, no? This is about the Christian and social media. How do we engage, no, as a Christians or as a believer sa social media? But before we jump right into the very nitty-gritty part dito sa ating lesson, no? Just a couple of history first. Now, the advancement in human knowledge, nung may nagkaroon ng advancement sa human knowledge, and with man's universal desire for connection, doon nag-give birth ang technological innovation, internet accessibility, proliferation of smartphones, and finally, later on, nagkaroon na tayo ng social media. As far as statistics is concerned, sinabi dito sa na-research ko that according to latest statistics, during the 2023, the number of daily active users on Facebook, daily active users, no, reached 2.1 billion people. And could you imagine if the entire population of all the earth is around 8 million population? So that would mean to say that one-fourth of the populations, no? They are active daily sa Facebook. According din sa nabasa ko that sa Twitter has 368 million monthly active users. So napakarami. YouTube has 4.95 billion monthly active users. So, siguro in the past where technology has not yet boomed, these are very strange, no? Makikita pa siguro natin yung mga bata naglalaro sa mga sa maraming places na nakikita natin na sa labas lang naglalaro. Pero because of the rise of technology, nakikita natin na nakakulong na lang sila sa kanilang bahay or sometimes doon sa probinsya na pinanggalingan ko sa Cebu. Dati maraming tao naglalaro doon, maraming mga bata, pero ngayon nandun na sila sa kanilang pamamahay. Because they're enjoyed doing and playing technology at doon sila nakatuon sa social media. Now, important to note here, mga kapatid, that social media is a wonderful tool. And being a tool, it is not inherently evil. It's not necessarily na evil siya. That is considered within the category of amoral, no? Neither moral or moral. And we are not absolutely against the use of social media, just to be clear, no? We see na meron din talagang mga certain benefits ang social media para sa atin. And I believe all of us here are enjoying social media as well. Ang social media, one of its benefits is good communication tool for gospel proclamation. In fact, maraming nagiging reform or maraming mga na-save dahil din sa panunood ng mga video, mga clips na nakikita natin sa social media. So, nagamit din siya sa Panginoon sa positive na mga bagay. Itong human creativity. It provides entertainment. Nai-entertain tayo sa social media. And a good platform to showcase also our talents. Kung magaling tayo mag-gitara, or magaling tayo sa musika, dito tayo na may mga marami mga tao na nagkakaroon sila ng viewership na dumami, sumikat dahil sa social media. And we can easily be updated with the latest happenings in the world. Not all of us probably enjoyed reading the newspaper, pero dahil tayo ay laging naka sa social media natin, sa kada-scroll lang natin sa newsfeed, nai-inform na tayo sa may balita pala na ganito, may news pala, may war pala na nangyayari. So, social media is very helpful sa mga bagay na yan, no? And then we can connect easily to families and relatives living abroad or in remote areas. In the past, kailangan pa nating magbayad ng napakamahal, no, sa telepono para makontakt natin yung mga people abroad. Or if a church is sending a missionary outside the country, napakahirap ng mag-send ng letter, tapos babalik ulit, mag-send ulit sila. It will take a couple of days, if not months, before natin matanggap yung correspondence. But social media right now, kung may pinadala tayo doon sa isang lugar, in just a flick of a finger, no, kaya natin silang i-reach out, and we are going to be updated sa mga nangyayari sa kanilang buhay or sa kanilang mission. So, there are some remarkable benefits na nakukuha tayo sa na nakukuha natin sa social media, but of course there's also a certain warning. While social media can function as a useful tool, no? Being a tool, it can function for good, it can also be a tool for evil, no? Just like a knife, pwede mo siyang magamit sa pagluluto. It's a positive thing, but it can be used also by evil people to stab someone and to commit murder. In the same way, ganun din yung social media, no? Nagagamit din siya, it can be used as a tool for evil. The reason being is simple, because humans in general are sinful and totally depraved. So we talk about earlier the evil, the benefits of social media. We can also talk about the drawbacks of social media or the disadvantages na meron ang social media. First, it can be a platform of uncontrolled ravings or ranting. So meron kang makikilala mga tao, no, sa social media na ang tahimik sa in real life. Napaka-bait, napaka-meek. But in social media, they became braver. Parang napakatapang na nila, no? And they express yung galit nila sa society and the people around us. They use this as a platform. Social media can become an outlet for gossiping and slandering. So meron ding mga patama, no, na nakikita natin, people are throwing shades against a certain person, and they use social media and pretend that it is a general statement, no, pero may mga maraming mga shades na tinutrow dito sa social media. Ginagamit nila ito na outlet. And for example, kung ikaw din ay magkakamali, if there's a one single post na controversial or you got a wrong notion of something, pwede din ang yung mistake can be advertised to a multitude of people sa social media. So yun yung mga drawbacks niya, no? Lead to embarrassment. And of course, social media has certain communication barriers. Ito yung isa sa mga bagay, no, na nakakalungkot. In social media kasi, when you communicate, walang bodily expression, hindi mo naririnig yung tone of voice ng tao, you don't hear it. And therefore, there are times that your statement that is meant to be a soft message and you have a different intent in your mind when you post that particular thing, but it can mean different things for different people because of the lack of mga verbal cues na hindi nakikita yung gesture mo, yung rhythm ng pagsasalita mo, juncture ng enunciation mo. So there are times that people can misinterpret, especially if we're typing in uppercase, no? Usually pag uppercase, naka-built-in sa atin na ano yun, galit. Pero I've known someone na lahat talaga ng ano niya, chat niya is uppercase. Pero nung na-meet ko siya in person, hindi naman pala siya galit, no? Pero there are cases like that. Meron din akong na-meet na ang reply lang niya talaga sa Facebook, this is one of my Bible study. Okay, ganun lang. Okay. Wala, interested ba kaya siya maano sa akin? All right, potential na po. Okay. There you go. So you see na ang message natin, especially sa Twitter, 'di ba? You are given a limited amount of words to express yourself. Kaya meron talagang mga negative reactions agad sa mga posts because of course that person cannot write a single, a very comprehensive essay to communicate his thoughts. Condensed lang talaga ang kaya niyang maibigay because of the medium that is limiting us. Kaya somehow, sabi ni McLuhan din, the medium sometimes becomes the method. Why? Because the medium provides a certain limitation of the message that you're trying to convey and you cannot convey it the way you actually do in real life. So, those are the drawbacks, no? Mga pitfalls na nangyayari sa social media. The point that I'm trying to get across here is that because of these limitations, because of this negative aspect, wisdom from scriptures is necessary to govern Christian behavior in its online sense, no? Now, let's look at first, the biblical foundation. Ano ba yung pundasyon, no, sa ating engagement sa social media? Now, let's look at the role of a Christian witness. So tayo, bawat mga Kristiyano, bawat isa sa atin, meron tayong role as a Christian witness. And one of which is, sinabi dito sa Matthew 5:13 through 16, sinabi that you are the salt of the earth and you are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. So therefore, there's a command, let your light shine before men that they may see your good works and praise your Father in heaven. Yun yung sabi ni Christ about sa Christian witness. Now, important to note that Christ makes it clear that it is the role of the believers to be gospel witnesses in this dark and sinful world. And this role natin, hindi lang siya limitado sa doctrines that we propagate sa social media, hindi lang itong mga federalism or whatever helpful doctrines in order for us to function as a light, or gumawa ba tayo ng podcast about or gumawa ba tayo ng video about gospel proclamation to the lost. It's not limited to that, but it also includes the quality of life that we live. Kasi nga sabi doon, that they may see your doctrines, that they may see your good works, no? In this dark and sinful world. Now, another thing, we have this from 1 Peter 2:12. This is a good foundation na binigay sa atin ng scripture to keep your conduct among the unbelievers, among the Gentiles, honorable. So, as a Christian, being a light of this world, meron tayong responsibility, no? That our life, if we are bearers of the gospel, sabi pa nga ni Thomas Godwin, if I can still get it right off the top of my head, sinabi niya doon na, if ang gospel, ang pinaka best message that was ever made, and if it is the greatest message at ang pinaka-noble na message na ating dinadala, then therefore our life must also correspond to that message that we bear. Hindi din natin hahayaan na yung mensahe na yon will be tarnished because of our ill behavior and bad character na pinapakita natin sa social media. Dapat we live inconsistent with the gospel. Now in Philippians 1:27, sabi dito sa atin mga kapatid, no? Whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel. It's true na none of us can live worthily of the gospel. Nobody could live a perfect life. But be that as it may, no? Tayo ay binigyan pa din ng Panginoon, binigyan tayo ng precept niya na although hindi man natin ma-reach yung perfection, but we strive to do our best according to His grace na mamuhay na worthy sa Ebanghelyo. Now, the point here is that the light of the believers, being the light of the world, permeates every area of their engagement. Na yung buhay natin bilang Kristiyano is not only limited to our life here in the church, right? Or our life here in a certain area. But bawat area ng ating buhay, yung light ng Ebanghelyo ay nag-permeate, whether in the church, family, workplace, or even on social media. Now, in Philippians 4:6, sinabi dito, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is truthful, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, ito yung guidelines natin as a Christian, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about this thing. This very thing can be a principle na ma-apply mo sa iyong behavior on social media. What I'm doing, something that is truthful. What I'm sharing in social media, something truthful. Is it something honorable if I do this? Or is it something commendable and lovely? Because if it is, then do it. If it's not, no, it's understandable that the answer is, don't do it. Now, let me share to you ethical principles na nakuha ko sa libro ni Jeff Johnson. This Jeff Johnson is not Jeffrey Johnson, mga kapatid, na author ng Kingdom of God. No, this is a different Jeff Johnson, who is also a Reformed Christian. Ang title ng libro niya, kung sa James meron tayong Taming the Tongue, sa kanya naman meron tayong Taming the Fingers. And I'd like to share to you, mga kapatid, this next slide, na ito'y galing sa kanyang libro mismo na baka maging helpful din sa bawat isa sa atin. So first question, no? When we go to, as we sail our way to the turbulent sea of social media, mga kapatid, no? Am I controlled? Yan yung unang question. Now, in this world, maraming mga tao na naniniwala na if you're a Christian, you need to always speak up. Dapat if may mga issue, you always have a word to say, di ba? Always natin yung napapakinggan na it's as if na ang silence is a form of violence. But if you're going to study the scripture, it's providing us a completely otherwise, no? That there is actually a virtue in what we call silence or being controlled. Now let's look at Proverbs 29 verse 11. Sabi dito, a fool gives full vent to his spirit, but a wise man quietly holds back. Do you see that? Important to note here na the writer of the book of Proverbs makes a distinction between a foolish person and a wise person. Ito yung wrong opinion, mga kapatid, no? That in every issue, Christian must always speak out. While silence can be evil, ito din yung clarification natin. While silence sometimes can be evil, in one case, there are situations also where silence is virtuous. Okay? So sabi ni Jeffrey Johnson, the foolish person daw always lets people know all that is going on in his mind and in his heart. So makikita natin itong taong to, marami siyang comments sa mga halos sa lahat ng mga bagay na nakikita niya sa social media. He always has a thought to share, to post, to rant always pag may nakikita siyang mali sa government. We saw this person na wala siyang control, no? It's good na magbigay tayo ng komento if we're going to give a comment because we are steered in our hearts just like the Apostle Paul doon sa Book of Acts, di ba? Nung nakita niya yung idolatry, may mga cases talaga that we need to speak. But if all of your life is characterized of always giving a certain answer to all the things that happen on social media, you always let people know what's going on in your mind, medyo problematic sa mga kapatid, no? Because it is probably an indication that you have an untamed spirit. Now, let us be warned that even a foolish person or a fool who keeps silent is considered wise. And when he closes his lips, he is deemed intelligent. So meron talagang case pala na ang pagiging silent natin is a form of intelligence. It's a form of being wise. So the point here is the ability to speak when it is proper and restrain oneself when it is not is a manifestation of self-control, which is one of the fruits of the Spirit. So may mga times na, for example, inatamay doktrina ka or may belief ka na there's someone in your newsfeed who's attacking that particular view, no? Tapos sabihin mo, papalampasin ko lang to. I will just let it pass. Scroll down ka. Parang sarap mag-reply. Balik ka sa pag-reply, no? In other words, hindi mo na-control talaga yung sarili mo. You are unrestrained or uncontrolled sa mga bagay na yon. And that is becoming problematic, no? Kung wala ka ng control sa sarili mo. So that's the first one, di ba? Am I controlled? The next one is, am I calm? Kalmado ba ako? Alright? So, sabi sa Proverbs 15:1, a soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word tears up anger. So, what would you feel if someone will speak angry words against you sa social media? No? May mga times na na-encounter natin na merong there's someone who come against us na galit na galit, no? Full of vitriolic languages na nileleveled against us, no? So what is your response? Do you respond with equally the same anger? Or do you respond as a calm person? Kasi sabi dito sa Biblia, no? A soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word tears up anger. I think this principle ma-apply natin sa ating, even sa ating family or sa ating workplace, na if you have a certain boss na galit, but you reply, you retorted with a very soft word and very respectful word, makikita mo na bigla siyang nagtotone down, nagsasubside yung anger niya. And that is from the principles of the Book of Proverbs na nakukuha natin, mga kapatid, no? So the Book of Proverbs indicates that being rude only furthers the conflict. So if someone is going against you very angry and you reply it with exactly the same level of angry words, so mag-further lang at mag-i-escalate lang yung conflict nyo sa isa't isa. So meron ang iba, no? They considered na if ma-block siya sa social media, they consider it as a badge of honor. Ipopost pa niya sa public, isi-screenshot pa niya, no? I was blocked by this person. He cannot respond to my argument. Tapos parang he takes pride on being blocked on social media. Is it a good thing? Is it something na best characterized as a Christian? I don't think so, no? And I believe we all of us agree on that. Sabi ni Johnson, when people feel attacked or belittled, they tend to immediately stop listening and not give serious consideration to what you have to say, even if what is said is accurate information or the truth of God's word. So kahit pa ang sinasabi mo ay God's word, biblical. It's a true statement that comes from the Bible. But if you delivered it in a manner that is very rude, very unloving, people will not listen to what you're going to say. Okay? So that yun yung when a certain, for example, if Calvinists are tagged as, for example, very arrogant, di ba? Kasi may mga nag-i-engage din sa social media na nakikita natin na the behavior is completely beyond the pale of yung mga language, clean language, yung mga pinagsasabi. And because of that, nagkakaroon na natuloy yung mga magagandang doctrines natin ng bad rap because of the characters of those people who propagate the doctrine or mga importanteng mga bagay na tinuturo. Kaya, kakalungkot, di ba? If you're going to visit a certain Armenian page, every time may Calvinist, they think na, I are Calvinist, arrogant. That's an arrogant person. That's very sad because Calvinism should humble those who hold it. Because imagine, it's teaching us the doctrines of grace. We should be gracious in return, no? Kung recipient talaga tayo ng napakaganda, napaka-precious na doctrine. So because of not guided by the scripture, so their engagement on the social media is not calm and it's not controlled, leading people to believe na otherwise than what they should. Now, alam ba natin mga kapatid, yung Israel, di ba may northern kingdom at southern kingdom of Israel, Jeroboam at King Rehoboam. Nung time na before pa na split, before they were about to split into two kingdoms, nag-ask si Rehoboam a certain advice from the old people, from the old men, counselors, in 2 Chronicles chapter 10, na what should I do? And these old people, sinabi nila that if you will be good to the people and please them and speak good words to them, then they will be your servant forever. But what did Rehoboam do? Anong ginawa niya? Nakinig siya sa mga advice ng mga younger men na maging rude. And so what he did? And the king answered them harshly and forsaking the counsel of the good old men. And what happened? Na-split yung north and southern kingdom. They chose Jeroboam na mag-lead sa atin. That promises of David for you, Rehoboam, solohin mo yan. You can have the Davidic promises and we will split dito kami. Of course, this is not the ultimate reason for the split, no? It's a very complex na issue, but this is one that triggers the division of Israel. Imagine, nagkaroon ng split ang Israel because of being harsh and being rude sa mga tao. The point that I'm trying to get across is a true believer. Kung tayo itunay na mananampalataya, this is also a challenge to us, no? That if you have known Christ's meekness, you're going to be charitable and calm in your speech, even in the face of heated controversy. So mahalaga yun, mga kapatid, no? That we are controlled and we are calm. Especially na ang medium na ginagamit natin, it's not personal, no? It's something na may mga communication barriers na marami tayong i-consider. Colossians 4:6 says that let your speech or speech be gracious, seasoned with salt so that you may know how you ought to answer. There are ample of biblical verses kung paano natin i-communicate ang ebanghelyo. Paano tayo mag-deal sa ibang person. These are very helpful. Next one is, am I conscientious? Okay? According sa book of Acts 24 verse 16, sabi ni Apostle Paul, I also do my best to maintain always a blameless conscience. To be conscientious is you're doing what is right according to the right conscience that is informed by the Bible. Now, important to note that Paul made it clear that it is the believer's duty. Duty natin, mga kapatid, no, to be conscientious. Ang definition is wishing to do what is right, especially to do one's work or duty well and thoroughly. Now, if that's the case, there are two things here. Una, how to be conscientious. Our intention must be consecrated. Meaning to say, in social media, dapat pure yung intentions natin. Okay? So, kasi merong mga negative things here, no? Let's talk about false communicator. Ano yung false communicator, Brother Jeff? Ito yung makikita mo sa social media, the one who disguises that his intention is pure. But deep down, his inner motive is filled with hatred. Ito yung tao na who uses social media to channel his anger against a person or the church and sugarcoats his post with scriptural wisdom, yet serves as a subliminal message to castigate a certain person or church behind, no? So magbibigay ng mga spiritual, mga biblical, biblical, may mga biblical wisdom ng mga post. Pero little did people know na ang kanyang pinost doon, although may mga scriptural verses and scriptural wisdom, it serves as he's targeting someone behind, no? Meron siyang someone that he's trying to target. So his intention is not clear, and people who likes and share and post it didn't know the real thing. But this person, false communicator, iba yung intention niya. Ginagamit niya ito as subliminal message to castigate someone. And this is something that we should be aware of. And if tayo, we should not be like this, no? Na hindi natin gagamitin yung social media para meron tayong babanatan, either yung church or a close friend of us na possible nakakabasa sa ating mga posts sa Facebook. This is very unchristian way. Next is a funny communicator. Alright? Itong funny communicator naman, mga kapatid, this is a person who deceptively cracks jokes but intended to cause harm or pain or embarrass his own neighbor. So meron mga tao na sinasabi, no, na joke lang, no? A joke lang yun. Pero, of course, hindi lahat siguro ng we have to remember that not all jokes lighten up the mood or build rapport. Some jokes are insult-laden and discriminating. May mga jokes talaga na nakakasakit. And once a certain joke is dead with that kind of intention, no, it fails to serve its purpose. Kasi ang joke is to lighten our mood, eh. Nagbibigay sa atin ng katiyahan, natutuwa ang both parties, the joker and the person that he was joking with. So, ganun dapat yung ma-achieve, no? Hindi yung isa natutuwa, pero yung isa nasasaktan, naiiyak na pala siya, na-embarrass na pala siya. And we saw that na may mga ganyan marami sa social media. And it's sad, no, na may mga Kristiyano na natitem to do kind of joke like that na nakakasakit na. It's not right, no? Because we ought to be to do some certain good to our neighbors. The book of Proverbs, itong klaseng tao na to, mga kapatid, no, na nagbibigay ng joke pero ang intention niya ay nakakasakit. Sabi dito sa Proverbs 26:18-19, like a madman who throws firebrands or arrows, and death is the man who deceives his neighbor and says, I was only joking. So, ganun pala siya. Hindi pala siya kinumen ng Bible. And in fact, the Bible takes negative about those things. So, siguro sa social media, no, we have to be guided with the scripture para makita din natin joking is very okay, no? Walang, there's nothing wrong with pag-joke, no? In fact, napaka-helpful nun because ano 'yun, nagbibigay sa, kung nasa sad moment tayo sa buhay natin, at least nagbibigay sa atin ng ano, parang hope sometimes, no? Na we can do it. Nagbibigay sa atin ng confidence. But of course, we have to be careful to the person that we are joking with na baka nakakasakit na tayo. And if we do so, and if we accidentally hurt the person by our joke, no? Let us approach the person and ask forgiveness towards that person. And that should be the thing that every Christian must do. Next is, your information is correct. Okay? In Exodus 20, verse 16, you shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. Malinaw na itinuturo sa Biblia sa atin na huwag tayo mag-bear ng false witness. There are cases in our life, no, na makita lang tayo ng mga sinishare na post concerning a person or concerning this thing, and then we did not validate whether that particular article is telling the truth. Na fact-check ba natin? Hindi. But we just share it to other people and we spread misinformation and things like that. Now, we have to be very careful because the Bible prohibits any form of lying, misinformation, and deception. Siguro, nung si Iman, ano, I forget the last name, yung, may maraming mga Christian, no, na nagsasabi na siya ay transgender nung una, kasi because they were not, hindi pa nila na-verify na nung birth pala, ay in-associate, ano siya, hindi pala siya transgender, meron lang siyang mga deficiency, no? And then, Christians are spreading that lies na transgender itong taong ito. Nagpa-transgender siya. So, sad thing is nung na-discover na ang fact, it actually goes against the Christian, no? Ang Christian na naman yung ano, ganito ba yung mga Kristiyano? So, nababasa ko din sa social media, and it's not really good, no? Na mag-spread ng misinformation. So, we have to validate before we pass information to others. Siguro kailangan muna natin i-verify, no? Hindi tayo agad-agad na, kumbaga may trending ngayon na issue. Makikisabay tayo agad. Dapat may post din ako dito. Dapat may i-share ko na agad dito. Sometimes nadadala tayo sa kung ano yung uso. What is in vogue in social media. Dapat may certain comment din ako dito. Dapat ibigay ko din yung certain remarks ko. But you haven't done your homework yet to fact-check whether that information is real or whether that information is objective. So as Christians, if we are servants of the truth, no? So we have to seek the truth first. We have to fact-check everything. Tingnan muna natin before, let's control ourselves first, no? Kung hindi pa natin na-verify yung mga certain things about any article na lumalabas, no? Or dun din sa social media, kung meron din kayong nabasa na si meron kayong mababasa na this person is going against his pastor, na ito yung pastor ko, he's very like this, hindi siya doctrinal, hindi siya ganun. Well, that information is only just one piece of information, no? And there are more information that you don't know yet. And don't believe it right away. Okay? If nanggagaling siya sa isa lang, nanggagaling siya from one source only, so hindi siya maganda na we have that we accept that gossip right away, no? So hindi yan dapat na pinapractice natin. And sometimes din we tend to believe things na fit in sa ating paniniwala, and that's what we call confirmation bias. Okay, meron akong slide dito na nakuha ko, mga kapatid, sa simplypsychology.org. Okay? Oh, kumbaga, if you're going to look at the facts and evidence, let's say yan yung entire facts and evidence, okay? Those are the things, those are the evidence that we ignore. And these things, yung small circle in between that actually na nakikita natin, which is a overlap ng facts and evidences and our belief, yun lang yung pinaniniwalaan natin or the evidence that we believe. Bakit pinaniniwalaan natin? Bakit yan lang ang piece of evidence na pinaniniwalaan natin? Because it corresponds to our belief system, leading us to turn a blind eye on the entire evidence that that should be seen with objectiveness. So, sometimes nafo-fall tayo dito sa tinatawag na confirmation bias. Pero if we are a servants of the truth, then let's accept the evidence as what it is, no? As what they are. Let them be what they are. And in order for us to be factual. So, that's how it is to be consensuous, Christian, no? To be consensuous involves purity of intention, na pure ang ating intention sa ating pag-propose sa mga bagay na yon, at we are not making a deceptive way para lang meron tayong i-castigate na person. And of course, accuracy of information, no? Dapat tayo ang mga kapatid, na tayo ang defender sa accurate information as a Christian. So here, this is just very short, mga kapatid, no? And I'd love to entertain questions. So in summary, tayo dito sa mundo, we are God's light in this dark and sinful world. Our conduct, be it offline, mapa-offline man, or online, it must be aligned with the gospel. On social media, dito we are to exercise prudence, no? We are, and wisdom that is based on scriptural principles. So, alam natin, mga kapatid, no, that not all of us here are ganun na ka-mature in how to engage in social media, no? Hindi lahat sa atin narit na yung maturity na yan, no? We are all growing by the grace of God. Pero ang solution nitong lahat ng mga ill behaviors na nangyayari sa social media, yung maging sa desire natin na makilala, to promote ourselves, di ba? Yung longing natin sa puso natin, kaya nandun tayo nakababad sa social media and portray a certain image there, grace ang solution nito, mga kapatid. Grace humbles us. And it humbles us because we have to remind ourselves that, isipin mo, mga kapatid, no? We are just saved by the grace of God. So if we are saved by the grace of God, that compels us, no? Na maging humble sa social media, na hindi tayo masyadong aggressive or zealous. Because sometimes, pag meron tayong, especially the young theologians that we have right now, sometimes if there are some precious doctrine that we have studied that we think na this is very, very good doctrine, that this is something that I need to share, sometimes we are imposing our doctrine to others. Parang gusto na natin na i-impose ito, and this is something that you must believe. You're not letting the person to study it first, right? Pag-aralan niya muna whether, para at least if that person accepts a certain doctrine, that person accepts it because he studied it. Hindi siya dahil napilit lang sa'yo na gumagamit ka ng mga strategies or techniques na if di mo to paniniwalaan, ganito ang mangyayari sa'yo. Dito ka sa heresy na ito. May mga ganun kasi na, ano no. But we just let the person grow. Pero kung meron tayong, if we understand grace, the humbling power of grace, then our interaction will be after this manner as well of being humble. And grace satisfies us, mga kapatid, no? God's approbation of us in Christ is enough to satisfy the longing of our heart, no? Hindi natin kailangan ng magkaroon ng mga maraming likes or maraming comments or maging popular online para lang masatisfy yung puso natin. Tayo ay, ang grasya ng Panginoon is very sufficient na magbigay sa atin ng satisfaction sa puso natin. Next is, grace unite us. So, the gospel not only reconciles us to God, sabi ng Biblia, Ephesians chapter 2, no? It reconciles us also with one another. So, you have to ask yourself, if ang pag-insist mo sa yung point of view, or yung perspective mo, isipin mo yung consequence nito. Does it reconcile us? Does it make us even more closer? And or does it destroy our friendship? Kasi kung if it destroys our friendship, we don't understand grace, no? Kasi sometimes nangyayari ito, no? Because especially if meron tayong iba't ibang, let's say, political view. Ito yung political leader na gusto ko. Ito yung iba na naman, ibang political leader naman yung gusto ko. Na may marami tayong ano. But in all of this, tandaan natin, no? That there is grace. And ito yung solution sa ating pagka-hiwa-hiwalay, mga kapatid. And yep, for the sources here, this is very short, but I hope that you've learned something from it, no? This is from Jeff Johnson's Taming the Fingers, The Heavenly Wisdom for Social Media. And also, Tim Chester, sa kanyang book na Will You Be My Facebook Friend? Social Media and the Gospel. But I highly recommend yung kay Johnson. There are other two pa na hindi ko na na-tackle dito, mga kapatid. And those websites that you see, doon yun ang galing yung mga other references na ginamit natin. So we're greatly indebted by all of those. So at this point, I think that will do it. And at least may ample time pa tayo for question and answer. I don't claim, no, that I am an expert on this matter. If there are things that I can answer, good. But if there are things that I don't know, I'm going to research that, no? At baka i-PM ko lang sa inyo yung sagot pag di ko alam. Sige. So let's open the floor now for question and answer. All right. Do you have other questions? Go ahead po. Hindi ko po narinig.
Yung question ko, kasi I think one of the exploding issues in regards sa social media is tuwing election.
Oh.
Yeah, so parang napansin ko lang nga, I mean, especially it became a hot topic sa churches kasi it destroyed a lot of relationships, mm-hmm. even Christian to Christian. So, kasi parang nangyari is people say of this regime na, ito yung facts, and then another will claim na ito yung facts. So, parang as a Christian, in that situation, are we just going to be, alam mo yun, silent about, ano, yung parang we don't have to really promote whoever we are campaign or whoever we are gonna vote for, parang would that be a wiser decision to do in the midst of like that kind of happenings or culture?
Oh, that's a very good question. Thank you, by the way, for the question. So I think there are times talaga na we see a certain candidate that we strongly believe na nakita talaga natin because nakita natin yung achievements niya or nagawa niya before, that we know this candidate really well. And because we believe na he can do better for our country and for the good of all the people, we endorse this person. And it's a good thing because meaning to say, you care about the people around you. Parang nag-care ka sa country, nag-care ka sa mangyayari sa mundo, and the benefit that it will give us, no? In general or as a whole. So I believe the intention of that is really just, it's really pure. Pero of course, there are certain, I would opine, no, na there are certain situations then that let's understand that people may not probably see the way we see things, no? Kakalungkot lang siguro for some people, dumating na sa point na parang gusto nilang ipilit They are trying to coerce the freedom of a person to believe by insisting that this should be the one that you believe, and uses certain strategies na kung tunay ka na Kristiyano, this should be the candidate that you're going to believe. Sa akin siguro hindi helpful kung ganun na yung style ng pangampanya, parang questionably ka na Kristiyano, you know what I mean, yung ganun na klase na strategy, parang hindi siya helpful, and hindi siya nagpo-promote ng ano, magandang dialogue sa mga bagay na yun. So in that case, yeah, we can discuss that and share that sa Facebook. Pero at least with a certain limitations din na may respect pa din tayo sa iba na may ibang viewpoint sa atin. And yun, yun ang tingin ko if we are Christian. Did I answer your question po? Oh, thank you very much. Si brother.
Romy, may mga good cases ba na we need to call out a brother in Christ sa social media? Kasi diba, we consider social media as a public space. Kasi iniisip ko lang, for example, may shinare siya na heretical. Tapos parang nag-a-agree siya doon. May mga ganong cases ba na we need to call someone out sa social media din?
Based on my experience, brother, no, this is based on my experience ko sa social media, I see a lot of benefit na i-PM mo yung tao. Kung for example, may heretical siya na view, I experience na people tend to listen to you and tend to correct their mistakes pag i-PM mo siya. Sir, excuse me, para kung heretical na po, hindi po ba to heretical ang inyong pinresent dito sa social media? I was just concerned. So kung ganun yung way ng approach natin, sa base lang sa experience ko, I'm not saying this is absolute, no? I could be wrong on this regard. Meron sigurong certain area na tama yon. But I believe na mas naging helpful yon na mag-change sa kanyang view rather than shaming that person online. Because the moment you shame that person online, may tendency na nakita niya yung sarili niya, na mali pala ako. Pero dahil a lot of people saw what happened, na parang napahiya siya, what he did is he's going to defend himself na. Ay, didepensahan ko lang to kasi nakataya yung ano ko, pangalan ko na napahiya ako. I have to stick with my guns to say na ito talaga ang tama. So that's the bad thing na nakukuha natin if we're going to ano, to do it in public, no? Pero may mga siguro may mga bagay na for example, kagaya ni Joel Osteen, no? Mga ganun na siguro na mga heretic na marami na talaga nag-subscribe, tapos publicly known na talaga yung ano niya, heresy niya. I think there's room na ma-warn din yung ibang tao. Alam, may post si brother na ito palang binabasa ko na si Joel Osteen. Ano pala to? Prosperity gospel pala to? Mali pala tong tinuturo niya. So, sa mga ganun, I think there's a benefit on that na to give awareness for the people about the heresy of this person, especially kung damaging ano talaga sa fundamental aspect ng faith natin yung at stake. So yun, especially marami ding nakikinig doon sa taong yun. So I see benefit na for public. Pero in normative case, I usually, this is just coming from my experience, mas nagbe-benefit na i-PM mo na lang yung tao. I saw a lot of benefit on that. And marami ako nakikita na nag-change siya when he's dealt in public, private than public. Okay. But of course, people will say, nag-post siya sa public, no? Dapat public ko din i-rebuke siya. That might be what they believe, pero my experience is otherwise. Based on ano ko, na-experience ko mga kapatid, no? So, helpful ang pag-ano private. I'm not sure if there are people who have different opinion. You can also share yours on that matter. Did I answer your question, brother? Great. Meron pa po ba? Go ahead, kapatid.
Hello, Brother Jezreel. It's John. I notice on some random, whatever random videos on YouTube or something, there are people that comment, let's say it's a video of the Olympics or of elections or whatever. And then there are random comments of people saying, repent and believe in the gospel or Jesus is coming soon. Are those appropriate comments, or I want to know what your thoughts are on if that's the time and the place, if it's sure, why not, or maybe people won't be so maybe they just might think that the person commenting is strange or weird.
Yeah, parang hindi din siya appropriate, no, na may ibang mga right. Ano, tapos may biglang I encountered that one brother also, no, na may pinapanood akong video na I think that was UFC or something, no? Tapos may biglang uppercase lahat. Repent and believe because the Lord Jesus Christ is coming. Ganon. Eh, ang reception ng tao sa ganon, no? Parang tinawanan lahat yung ano niya, yung comment niya na ganon. I just think, brother, no, the scripture is replete of examples na there are times, no, na under a circumstance or certain context na ilagay natin properly yung gospel witnessing na hindi din siya maging katawa-tawa sa ibang tao na parang sinasadya natin na masyadong off topic naman to, parang ganon. So hindi maganda, no? Kagaya nung kay Job, no? Example lang, parang may similarity lang dito na it's not that the person is mourning, is in great pain and distress, no? Tapos, you are going to mock using the sovereignty of God. Or let's say, may namatay na tao. Tapos, ang ito, iano mo sa kanya, huwag kang masad. God is sovereign, no? Di ba? Pansin mo ganun. So, yung truth na yun ay hindi appropriate sa situation na yun na ganun. So, in the same way, sa gospel din, I think may tamang, this is just my opinion, no? A person can say na, in any situation, season or out of season, you can preach the gospel. Pero sa akin, let's put it in a way na hindi din sa parang yung behavior na natin ang naka-question. Kasi kung ganun, parang yung behavior na ng tao na nagpo-post yung na-question. Pero if you're going to do evangelism or doing some tract distribution or street preaching na mahinahon at respectful, wala namang problema. Pero yung mga comment lang na ganyan, pero sa akin medyo strange lang, no? And I would not do that siguro sa ako, sa akin. Does anybody here have a different opinion than mine? Feel free to contradict me. Anyone? Did I answer your question, Brad?
Yes, thank you.
You have a follow-up or what?
Wala.
Go ahead, Brad.